Thank you for joining this presentation on the Zoom Stroke Solution. My name is Doug Boyd, Vice President of Marketing with Imperative Care. It's my privilege to introduce Dr. Justin Wisnett. He's an interventional neuroradiologist based in Tampa, Florida. Dr. Wisnett is the chief of 6 neurointerventional hospitals in the HCA West Division, and he's graciously offered to present his experience with the Zoom system here with everyone. He has pioneered the technology into the HCA system nationally, and he's willing to share both his clinical experience with the Zoom stroke solution and also some operational learnings of his through the HCA system. So without further ado, Dr. Wisnett, I will turn it over to you.
All right, thanks, Doug. Hey, everybody, and thanks for joining. Getting together today to talk about these Imperative Care catheters and look at our results in West Florida in our early experience using these. My disclosures, here you can see that. We're a group of 8 interventional neurointerventionalists at 6 hospitals here in West Florida. You can see this map shows the kind of broad geography we're covering all the way up north at Bayonet Point down to Fawcett Memorial, which is in Port Charlotte, and as far east as Brandon, and then all along the West Coast. Tampa's kind of right in the middle of these, and how do we cover all these places is we have a primary and a backup call system, and we just split the coverage up between the 8 of us. So looking at the Zoom catheters, the catheter system has basically a broad range of sizes all the way up to the Zoom 88, which is the first catheter that's meant to be taken intracranially as a sort of like a guide catheter and an intermediate catheter in one. We'll look at some of the advantages that creates here in a few minutes. We also have a full platform of aspiration catheters, the Zoom 71, Zoom 55, Zoom 45, and Zoom 35. They're tailored to be used for the appropriate vessel size. So the 71 is really meant for distal ICA, proximal MCA out to the proximal M2. Zoom 55 is meant to be used for M2s and maybe the proximal M3. And then Zoom 45 is really meant to be used for more distal stuff, including the M2, but also M3s. And I don't really ever go past that. The really unique feature of the catheters is they're very, very soft and trackable, and they have this TRX tip, which is an angled tip. And by angling the tip, it really creates a larger area of the distal lumen. So the Zoom 71 is an 076 when you look at it in area in that beveled configuration. So even though it tracks like a 71 catheter, but you get much more aspiration force. Zoom 55 distal tip surface area is 059, and the 45 is 048, and the 35 is 038. So what is unique about these catheters is, number one, the position of the guide catheter, Zoom 88. It's meant to be taken all the way up intracranially, where it goes around 6 turns, and this means that when you do your thrombectomy passes, you have less distance to go with your aspiration catheter, fewer turns, and you have flow control. So let me show you what I mean by that. Well, as you can see on these lines at the top, when you get the Zoom 88 up into the distal ICA, you're creating an approximately 87% stenosis. So I like to think of it as almost working like a balloon guide. You're not really totally occlusive, but you're nearly occlusive, and you don't get that blood flowing past your aspiration catheter, which can potentially cause emboli. If you look down here in the lower right-hand corner, you see that with the Neuron Max or an 088 catheter up in the distal cervical ICA, you don't really create a significant stenosis. So you don't have any protection from that blood flow. So these are in vitro studies showing on the left, this is a traditional 068 aspiration catheter. Oh, this is a 071 Zoom 88 with the Zoom 70, Zoom 88 all the way up at the same level. Let me play that again. So right here you have the Zoom 71 and right next to it you have the Zoom 88. And you can see the whole clot being engulfed. And this Zoom 88 is really peeling the clot off the edge of the wall there and allowing it to be aspirated. This is a more traditional A68 and Neuron Max. And you can see as the clot is pulled, it has to come down 10 centimeters around all the six turns, and that's where clots can be lost and cause embolization. So again, the unique feature of these catheters is what they call the TRX tip. It's an angled tip or a bevel tip. It's very, very soft. It's the softest polymer distal to the marker band on the market. By creating an angled tip, the surface area of that tip is 15% larger and also tracks really well. So comparing some of the other aspiration catheters on the market, you can see the Zoom 71 has a 2.94 tip opening, whereas Vecta 74 is 2.77, Jet 7, 2.63, large bore catheter 2.55, React also 2.55, and Sophia, the 6-French Sophia is 2.48. On the lower right-hand corner, you see that this round tip, after it's cut in that oblique way, it actually, the 071 diameter goes all the way up to 076. So these are videos showing this angled tip and how it can engage the clot. Oh, I thought this was a video. With the angled tip, you engage the side and the bottom of the clot, and that larger surface area allows the entire clot to be ingested, whereas with the flat tip, it's more like a mushroom and there's less ability to pull the whole clot in. This is an in vitro study that when they first started looking at these catheters, and they did 10 aspiration passes with a flat tip catheter and 10 aspiration passes with the beveled tip catheter. And you can see here, there was, as shown in this video, that there's a lot higher rate of ingestion of the whole clot using this opening. So here's a study. A multi-center retrospective cohort where they looked at angled tip being associated with improved technical outcomes as compared to using all the other aspiration catheters on the market, all the way from the 064 to 074 aspiration catheters. 650 patients with M1 occlusion analyzed from 15 high volume thrombectomy centers. 162 patients were in the Zoom 71 cohort, 488 patients were in the 064 to 074 internal diameter cohort. The results are they saw a higher rate of TPTC, 67% versus 59% with Zoom 71, reduced time from access to reperfusion, 21 minutes in the Zoom 71 cohort, which is a 29% relative reduction in the time to the TQ2C. They also saw reduced stent retriever usage from 25% versus 44%, which is a 43% relative reduction. And these are some of the same things we're seeing in West Florida. Here's a video just showing how the Zoom 88 tracks over the Zoom 71. You can see how smooth it tracks around these turns all the way out into the distal M1. So in HCA West Florida, these are our data over the last several months. We were using the Zoom catheters for ischemic. We've done 17 thrombectomies. 65% of those cases were TQ3, 11 out of the 17 procedures. 72% of the TQ3s were in the first pass. 71% TQ2C or better, 94% TQ2B or better, and 59% of the cases, 10 out of 17, were only one pass. The average time from access to reperfusion is about 20 minutes. We attribute that to the higher clot ingestion with the TRX tip. We've had only one stent retriever bailout out of the 17 cases. and we've had no procedural complications, no dissections, no perforations, and no catheter malfunctions. We're also using the Zoom 88 for our hemorrhagic cases. We've done TrackStar 88 for our hemorrhagic cases. We've done 9 hemorrhagic cases with TrackStar. 2 of those were flow diverters. We still used an intermediate catheter in those 2 cases. 4 of those were web. We used an intermediate in 3 out of those 4, and 3 were coiling, and we didn't use any intermediate in the coiling cases. Again, we have had no procedural complications, no dissections, no perforations, and no catheter malfunctions. So for hemorrhagic, the catheter is called the TrackStar. It's not as long as the Zoom 88, but it has the same properties of being really soft, distally, and large. This can be used if you're doing flow diverters, flow diverter plus coiling, intrasaccular embolization, balloon or stent-assisted coiling. It's a good catheter for venous access and for intracranial stenting. I particularly like the TrackStar for pipeline coiling or for flow diverter with coiling where you need to jail your microcatheter in the aneurysm. You can get the TrackStar up intracranially and use your coiling microcatheter side by side with your 27 catheter to jail your coiling microcatheter in the aneurysm. The other advantage is with only one catheter and no intermediate catheter, you don't have as many flush bags to keep track of. You don't have as many catheters to manipulate. It makes it a less complicated setup. So we have some example cases here. One of the really important things about using these catheters is that you can't use the exact same technique you would use for a cervical 88 catheter. You really need to take the catheter up high, at least into the distal cervical ICA, because it's so soft distally that it's not going to be supportive if you leave it down in the neck or down in the common carotid. So here's just an example of what I'm talking about. This is a stroke in the left MCA, and this is the initial ascent. This is with an 038 glide wire, which I'm tracking around this loop in the carotid. You can imagine with a Neuron Max or an Infinity 88, you would be parking at that below that curve, but with the Zoom 88, you track it all the way around. I don't like to take a wire up past the horizontal petrous, an 038 or an 035 glide wire. I don't like to take it up much higher. So at the end there, you can see I'm just pushing the catheter with nothing in front of it. And it's just so soft that it will go where the only way it can go, which is up. So this is the same patient. And you can see this patient has a left M1 occlusion. The Zoom has gone all the way around that loop in the neck and is positioned up in the posterior genu of cavernous ICA. We do a thrombectomy pass with a 71. My technique is typically to try to just push the Zoom 71 with nothing in front of it and just see if it goes to the clot for an M1. If not, then I'll usually put in a microwire and just track it over a microwire. But you always have the option to use a triaxial setup and put a Zoom 35 and track over that. You can see we got TK3 revascularization. This was a one pass case, 15 minutes. Case number 2, this is another stroke, right M1 occlusion. Again, using the Zoom 88 and Zoom 71. Another one pass success case. This is TK3 in 11 minutes. There's a lot of time saving doing it this way. Same case, this is showing you, this was a really large clot. You can sort of see through the catheter here, and you can see that almost 90% of this clot is engulfed in the catheter with just a little piece of it sticking out the tip. And of course, when you push it out of the catheter, you can see the clot broken in half. Case number 3, another stroke. This is the left proximal M3, and you can see the bifurcation is down here, and then there's this M2 coming up, and then right at the beginning of this left frontal M3, there's a little stump. We took the Zoom 88 all the way up into the cavernous ICA and left it there. And we tracked a Zoom 45 out to the clot, and you can see we got this one to come out, small little clot next to it here on the table. Again, one pass in 13 minutes. So this is case number four. This is another example of the ascent, which is just really important that you ascend the catheter up into the skull base at the beginning so that you maintain your access. So I like to track my select catheter all the way into the horizontal petrous. So this is just selecting the left carotid. This has a little bit of tortuosity, but not a loop as it goes up. Then I bring up the select catheter along with the Zoom 88, and I try to get the select catheter right at the skull base or even into the horizontal petrous if it will go there. But then after I get the Zoom around into the horizontal petrous, I think it's a good chance to just push the catheter with nothing in front of it because it's so soft, it will just go. So these are the intracranial images in the same patient. Again, this is a distal left M1.
We have the Zoom 88 up in the posterior genio cavernous. Next slide. And again, we have one pass TQ3 with the Zoom 71. You have a little vasospasm where we had the catheter tip was parked. Okay, next slide. This is another example of just how well these catheters track. This is Zoom 45 going around a loop in the M1. And the lateral shows it best where there's actually just a loop there, a redundant loop to get all the way out into that M2 clot, just tracking the Zoom 45 over a wire. Next slide. Okay, so another example of just the initial ascent of getting that Zoom 88 up. That's one of the most challenging parts is to actually just make sure you get the Zoom 88 where it needs to go from the beginning. This is Zoom 88 tracking over a 6 French Berenstein with an 038 glide wire. Same technique, really. Take the wire all the way up to the skull base. And then take the select catheter near the skull base. And then after you get the Zoom 88 into the horizontal petrous, just keep pushing it and it'll just track all the way up into the cavernous. Okay, next slide. So this was a case, this is the same patient. These are the unsubtracted pre-images showing a proximal M1 occlusion. Next slide. This is a case where again, my technique is to just push the Zoom 71 with no wire and no microcatheter right to the clot and see if it will go there, the snake technique. So in this case, the snake technique worked, and we actually were able to track the Zoom 88 all the way up past the ICA terminus to prevent emboli from occurring, and the whole clot came out, as you can see on the right. Next slide. This is a case that I just put on here because it's just really challenging and terrible anatomy to deal with. A very elderly patient with a lot of loops in the carotid. And because of the arch and the angle between the arch and the right common carotid, I decided to go radial. So I go to the next slide. These are videos from right radial access through the Zoom 88. Again, just showing this extreme tortuosity of the common carotid and the proximal internal carotid has a double loop in it. So we took the Zoom 88 there on the video on the right up into the proximal ICA. And then we do our first head run and you can see there's an M1 occlusion. Next slide. So the first intracranial pass, partially restored flow, but you can see we have a distal occlusion now. And so the next video on the right shows a Zoom 45 tracking out to that distal M3 clot, keeping in mind that we have all that loop down in the arch and the neck, and this Zoom 45 still just tracks with ease out to a distal location like this. Next slide. And after that, we got a small clot down in the aspiration canister, and the vessels are open. We got TK3 recanalization. It took a long time, 38 minutes. But with that kind of anatomy in the neck and having to start with radial access, it can add time to your case. Next slide. So that's the end of the ischemic cases. Now we're going to look at some of our hemorrhagic cases. This is a recent case with a TrakStar 88, and it's a pipe coil. I really like using the TrakStar 88 with the coiling microcatheter and jailing the coiling microcatheter next to the O27 microcatheter to deliver the pipeline. Next slide. And these are again, you know, sequential images showing the coil jailed within the aneurysm with a pipeline that I've pushed up to where it bulges into the aneurysm. To try and kind of tighten the pipeline interstices and improve the flow diversion. Okay, next slide. And there's the final result. It was not a ruptured aneurysm. I was just putting a coil in there to try and improve the flow diversion or improve the stasis. Next slide. This is an ACOM aneurysm. Again, you can see the TrakStar is up in the cavernous ICA. I've still mostly been using intermediate catheters when I do web, especially an ACOM can be the most difficult thing. So there's a 5-French Sophia at the ICA terminus, and you've got a VIA 21 inside the aneurysm. And next slide. And these are videos showing the final result. You can see the web is oriented properly across the neck. We have good stasis, and we're able to do good runs through the the TrakStar 88 around the 5-French Sophia. Next slide. And this is a balloon coiling. This is a ruptured ophthalmic ICA aneurysm. I think there's a septal balloon across the neck of the aneurysm. And I'm using that to hold these large coils in this large aneurysm. We got a really good result, complete aneurysm occlusion. Next slide. All right, so just in conclusion, you know, these imperative care catheters are on contract with HCA now. We're using the Zoom catheters and the TrakStar all over West Florida. It's really important that you track the 88 catheter up intracranially at the beginning and not leave it down in the common carotid or proximal ICA where it can buckle because it's so soft. And sizing these aspiration catheters to the size of the vessel, the Zoom 71 is meant to go as far as M2, Zoom 55 is for M2, M3, and then Zoom 45 is for anything beyond the M2.